Good evening, everyone, and welcome to Builder International's 2020 annual supporter reception. Though things have to be done a little bit differently this year, the positive is that we can have people logged on from all over the world, which is fantastic. This time last year, just about, I was lucky enough to head out to Zambia along with 10 other cyclists for a fundraising challenge, which meant that I got to see firsthand the incredible work that Build It do, how vital it is, and how much it is truly appreciated. So wherever you are, thank you so much for joining us and supporting Build It. Just so you know how this evening is going to go, we'll be here for about 45 minutes. We have interviews with beneficiaries in Zambia. We're also going to have a Q&A with a panel. So please do send in your questions. You should be able to do that on Ustream. And we're also going to be hearing from Andrew Jowett, the co-founder, who's got a big announcement at the end. So definitely stay tuned for that. If you're on social media, please do use our hashtag if you're sharing anything. It is hashtag building brighter futures. I hope that you're all comfortable, and shall we get started?
We are going to have a very fantastic time. You are very much welcome. Please.
Built It International, built as a science laboratory. Oh, it has created a bigger difference in the academic life of our children. It means even learner performance has greatly improved.
Welcome to the Center for Excellence. Behind me is a 2-hectare site where Build It's flagship project for the next few years is starting to take shape.
Kuzama skills za kusambira panwini. Kuzipanpare ama courses ya ripo. Pari plastering, pari bricklaying na painting na carpentry.
Our trainees are some of the best out there, which makes them highly employable.
People are getting supplies like, wow, I can't wait to sleep in a house built by women. So I was very high, I felt nice.
We are actually achieving a lot of things, and we've seen lives being transformed, young people being empowered.
Andrew, who you just saw briefly in the video there, co-founded Build It International in 2007 with a small group of experienced international development professionals. This year, Andrew, for the Queen's New Year's Honours, has been awarded an OBE for the work he's done for education in Zambia, a true testament to his dedication and the passion that he has. Now, after our bike ride last year, we know that Andrew can ride a bike. The question is, can he work Zoom? Andrew.
Hi, Zani. Thanks very much. I'm doing my best. And thanks for doing that ride. You were brilliant to have along.
Experience.
Yeah, you've recovered, I hope.
Yeah, it took me until last week to get back on a bike, but I'm back on.
Okay, well, hello everybody, and wherever you are, I hope you're safe. And you know, we're all absolutely thrilled you've joined us this evening or this morning, if you're west of here. It's a real boost to me and the whole team to know that so many supporters from across the world are with us right now. So thank you so much. You know, together we're creating something really special in Zambia, an organization that's helping to change thousands of lives every year in some of the poorest communities. So I'd like to briefly bring you up to date with what we've achieved over the past year and explain how we've responded to the challenge of COVID-19. But first, a very brief introduction for those of you who are new to us. So we're a UK and Zambia registered charity or a not-for-profit with a mission to create opportunities for young people and their communities. We're focused on Zambia, where the need is substantial and the people are fantastic. So it's a really, really good place for us to work. Now, at the heart of our approach is our Training Into Work initiative. And the young men and women selected to join our program are usually unemployed and with limited formal education. They are desperate for a way to earn a decent living. And over around 8 months, we work with them. First of all, to develop their life skills, teamwork, communication, timekeeping, stuff I'm still working on, really, really important out there in the workplace. To become competent in a practical skill, 400 hours of quality training in a range of trades. And critically, a really important thing for us is that we ensure they all get at least 3 months real work experience. And we all know how valuable that is in starting your career. So what did we achieve in 2019? Well, it was a record year with 223 graduates, representing 94% of those enrolled. So well done to all of you. If there's any on this broadcast, well done for completing the course and starting your career as a skilled worker. We also piloted our fifth course in plastering, and we established a really, really important relationship with the respected international awards body, NOCN, and they endorse all our courses, so providing assurance of the quality of our training. Now, although we haven't been able yet to conduct our annual impact survey this year, we do know that from the last 7 years of surveys, well over 70% of our graduates enjoy a significant and sustained increase in income. Now, for their work experience, the trainees follow one of three pathways. First of all, at one of our community projects, I'll show you a few slides in a second. And secondly, with a local contractor. We had 9 working with us last year, and they are really, really important partners for us. So thank you to them. And the third pathway is working with a partner organization. And Sugra's going to say a little bit thing about a new project with the National Youth Reform Institute down in Livingston. So in 2019, we completed 3 more community projects, making 47 in total. And we are very, very proud of these projects. The level of workmanship and the quality of the work is fantastic. Our simple reverse designs work really well. This one is at a town called Mukuyu, west of Lusaka. Well over 200 children will be enjoying these new classrooms once the school reopens. Our thanks to our friends at Trillium Foundation for helping with this project. The next one is at Nalianda, another fantastic project, supported largely by our friends at the BGL Group. I think there's lots of them on the call tonight. Thank you, guys. Here, enrollment has incredibly increased from 450 to 700 children since the building was finished earlier in 2020. And the government since allocated 4 more trained teachers. Now, at all our projects, toilets, latrines, loos, whatever you want to call them, they're really, really important, not just for good hygiene, but for helping to keep girls in school. This block is at Chitakuku, where we completed a second year of work last year. And our thanks to Edith Murphy, Hal Crow, and many others for supporting this project. But most of our trainees come through our Centre for Excellence in Lusaka. You saw some images of the training centre in that short film. So this is an updated master plan, a grand design, if you like. We've built everything that's in green, and we're still working on the orange this year, I think, Sugra. And in the next few years, the parts in purple. And our vision is that this centre, will become a focus point for promoting quality skills training in Zambia for many, many years to come. So I'd like to say a huge thank you to everybody who donated to Build It and supported our work financially last year. This was a record year, just pipped 2018. To all our regular donors and grant makers, we really, really appreciate your generosity. We're now over halfway to securing the £10 million we need to reach 150,000 people under our Building Brighter Futures appeal. I'd especially like to thank all the cyclists who did the trip and raised over £60,000, to the members of our development board and to their young offshoot, our Young Professionals Board, which was launched last year, from whom I'm sure we're going to hear much more over the coming years. So how have we been impacted by COVID-19? Well, in Zambia, the virus is present, but hasn't yet taken off to the same degree as in other places. There are around 1,500 confirmed cases so far, confirmed cases as of this morning. Nevertheless, all schools and training centres, including ours, were closed in March and are only now partially opening. We do feel that the virus has some way to go. Fortunately, we have been able to continue some of our building works, as Sugra will explain. We moved quickly in March to ensure that all our staff were kept as safe as possible and our trainers as well, with the majority probably like yourselves working from home. We also adjusted our spending plans to bring costs in line with an anticipated reduction in income. The charity sector in the UK is suffering at the moment. In fact, our income is holding up well. We contacted many of our supporters and their response has been fantastic, with three or four major new grants and lots of support coming in. So thank you to everybody for responding. Overall, we reckon around a 10% reduction in income this year, but our financial position is sound, and thank you all. Now, I'm especially proud that we've got onto the front foot in terms of our program response. Sugra will be explaining how we've quickly developed some distance learning materials for our trainees. And Billit's determined to play its part in supporting the wider effort in Zambia to prepare communities to deal with the virus. And tonight we're launching a new initiative, more on this at the end of the program. So overall, our direction of travel remains the same: to create the best, most effective vocational training program in Zambia. COVID-19 is not knocking us off course. It may be slowing us down a bit, but it's also helping us to think creatively. So in summary, we had a brilliant 2019. It was a record year. We're adjusting to the COVID challenge. We expect 2021 to be a tough year, but we're ready for that challenge, and we know you will be too. So to all our supporters, everybody watching, and to my colleagues, board members in Zambia in the UK, everybody in our community of support, a big, big thank you. Zikomo.
Thank you so much for that update, Andrew. It's great to hear the progress and see the finished product in the pictures there. It was so amazing actually getting to go and visit the Centre for Excellence, and it's great to see that it's still moving along as well.
Yeah, there's nothing like being there. But anyway, we'll do our best with the interviews coming up.
Well, like you said, the coming up, it's going to be challenging with the COVID situation. However, having seen yourself and other Big Build It supporters cycle through sand, I know that you can be slowed down but not stopped. So we'll keep ploughing on. Okay, so now we're going to be hearing from Doreen, who some of you might recognise. She was here last year. Doreen is the head teacher at Linda School. Now, having actually gone there and met them, we were there, we got the most insane welcome. It was all singing and dancing and laughs, and it wasn't just the teachers, it was the children and all their families. It was really quite amazing. But it's also was really clear while we were there that there were very vulnerable children, and which really kind of enforce the fact that even just the routine of going to school is so, so important. So we're going to hear a little update from Doreen now. Doreen, first of all, it's so great to see your face. How are you?
I'm very fine. And how are you?
I'm great, thank you. I can't believe that it's nearly been a year since you welcomed us so merrily to Linda School. It was amazing. The world's changed a lot since then.
Mm-hmm. You're right.
How have things been for you?
Oh, it has been a very busy year. We started very well in January, but things changed along the way. We had to close the schools abruptly on 20th of March. Children had to go back to their home, and they've been out from that time until 1st June, when government announced that the schools, that is the pupils that are writing exams in the year 2020, should be the ones that should retain. So at the moment now, we have the grade sevens and the grade nines learning, observing the medical guidelines that have been put in place.
So
far, so good.
So far, so good. Good. And has it been quite a challenge getting them into the classroom safely?
It has really been a challenge, but it is something that has been worked on. You know, as Linda Community School management in particular, we treat challenges as stepping stones. We've been all around looking for things, you know, to help them, you know, learn in a conducive environment.
Yeah. So the schools reopened for the grades 7 and 8. How do you think with the other children it's affecting their education?
The examination classes are the ones that open, that is grade 7 and grade 9.
Okay.
It's really a big toll on the other grades that haven't opened because they're just all over in the streets walking about. You know, these are the people whereby even just staying at home has been very difficult.
Yeah.
Okay, they could have managed maybe in the first week, but now we are beyond 2 months. It has really been a challenge. And the biggest thing is that they are now off learning. We are a school that keeps vulnerable children or pupils that come from underprivileged, you know, homes. We are just having a smartphone is a challenge in itself. And because of that, most of them have been off learning from that time. So I know it is something very, you know, tedious for the families, you know, to keep these vibrant, you know, and energetic youths at home.
Yeah, it's a real challenge. I mean, we're very lucky here, we can learn from home. So these children are getting no education at all while this epidemic's going on.
Mm-hmm.
Nothing. That's very tough. But tell me how many children you do have in the school. I know the school has over 2,000 students. So how many are managing to be in the school at the moment?
At the moment, I have about 400 pupils that have come back, those that are in the examination classes.
Yeah. And how have they responded to coming back? Are they really happy to be there?
The first day, it was a bit, you know, difficult because most of them had not acquired the face masks. But upon learning that we're giving out, you know, face masks to them free, the following day, most of them attended. Actually, as I speak now, attendance has been awesome. Very good.
Good, good. I know from when we visited, having spoke to some of the children, a lot of them were, it really surprised me how dedicated they were to learning. And they all had very big dreams. They wanted to be journalists, doctors, you know, lawyers. So it's great to hear that they're managing to get back in for their exams and that you're managing to make it work, even though it is a big challenge.
Yes. Managing actually, and the beauty is that now in their classroom they're about 20. Can you imagine from teaching children who are 80 to now teaching 20 in class? It has been a very, very, you know, a good setup on the side of teachers.
Yeah, so it's been actually quite nice for the teachers because they can have spent more time with individual pupils.
Correct.
Yeah, and I bet they're enjoying that as well because they'll be getting much more from it.
We are enjoying, actually. We are enjoying.
Well, it's good. You're finding the positives. That's what we've got to do, isn't it? So, Doreen, the main message that we've been told by the government in the UK is to just wash our hands regularly and stay safe that way. Has that been quite a challenge for you there?
It has been a challenge in the sense that at the moment we are just using, you know, buckets. You move them on in the morning and then you remove them in the afternoon. It's just that act of shifting and bringing them back is not sustainable. Just a day ago, we had, you know, maybe others accidentally breaking them. I think what you've been talking, I've been hearing, a permanent wash station would do for us.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I can't imagine, that's a very big job in itself, having to replenish the water regularly. And actually at the moment, when you've got a smaller number of pupils in, it might not need done quite so often. But when you've got all the pupils back there, I mean, that's a lot of work, and actually very difficult to even keep that clean. So I know that Build It are going to be putting in some washing stations, which hopefully will help with the pupils' hygiene going forward and be a longer term solution, something that will last a long time for the school. Hopefully a good addition, make things maybe a little bit easier. At least then you won't need to carry the buckets.
Mm-hmm. No, that would be a very good move on our side.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I hopefully that will be in as soon as possible. And it's a very strange time, and I really appreciate that you've taken the time out to chat to me when I know you've got pupils in studying for their exams. So thank you so much for chatting to me, and hopefully, yeah, things will start to look a bit brighter on the other side of this crazy time, and that the wash stations will help. Okay. It's been lovely to see your face again, Doreen.
Thank you so much. God bless, and regards to everyone that side.
And to you. Yeah. Take care. Bye.
Bye-bye.
The lovely Doreen. So next, we are going to be hearing from one of Build It's newest bricklaying trainees and hearing what life is like for her in Zambia. This is Maria.
Hi, good afternoon. My name is Mariam Tambo. I'm 21 years old. I'm doing bricklaying and plastering. Yeah. Where do I live? I live with mom. I live in 10 miles, I mean, Chiwombo district. I live with my parents, mom and dad. Yeah. What made me apply for the training? I really wanted to do something different from other ladies and to make a difference in my family. What mom said when I told her, mom, I'll be doing bricklaying, she was like, Iwe, what's wrong with you? Why are you doing men's job? I was like, mom, it has really motivated me, but mom wasn't happy with the training. Until now, she's not happy, but I'm trying to motivate her. I feel so good because, I feel good being on the training. What I've enjoyed most in the training is the hospitality that the administration has been giving us and the management at large. And nothing has been more difficult in this training, yeah, for now. Since the training was stopped in March, I stayed home for a week, then later joined a certain company, Simba Oil. I joined as a bricklayer. Then until now, I'm working with them as a safety officer. Learning with the tablets so far is so good. I can't complain. I'm really enjoying with the lessons that the lecturers have been giving us. After the training, I would love to work for someone. Then later on, after 2 or 3 years, I would love to open my own construction company. I would love to change the mindset of ladies, especially us women in the society, on construction or doing other jobs. I would want to say thank you to the sponsors that have been sponsoring us. I really thank you, and I pray that God may continue blessing you and adding more to your lives.
It's great to hear from Maria and how positive she is and how big she's thinking for the future. The fact that Build It give women opportunities and have so many women that they train is one of the things that drew me to them in the first place. So it's great to hear her chatting like that. We're now going to hear about the challenges faced at Libuyu. I'm sorry if I didn't say it right. We're now going to hear about the challenges faced at Libuyu. Oh gosh, sorry. Clinic. So the clinic serves 20,000 people, and we're going to be talking to Dr. Manyara, who is the chief medic there.
Hello, my name is Dr. Manyara Mchabona. I'm a medical officer at Libuyu Clinic. I attend to the outpatients, seeing general cases as well as the obstetric cases. So Libuyu Clinic, the way it's set up, we have an outpatient with the two screening rooms, which one is located in the actual outpatient department. The other one is located in the mother and child and health department because of space. So we are basically squatting, you would say. And then we also have the maternity ward, which is adjacent to the laboratory. So then the other facilities that we have is the HIV clinic. We also have a TB clinic, and the pharmacy as well. So basically those are the facilities or the services that run at Libuyu Clinic. So Libuyu caters for a population of about 22,000. So yeah, the population and the type of people, really most of them are poor people, and it's highly populated, though it's a high density area, Libuyu, yeah. So some of the problem that the clinic, or the challenges that the clinic is facing at the moment, is the arrangement of the clinic. It doesn't have a patient friendly floor. And then the other challenge that is there is that our maternity wing is located just next to the laboratory. So you have clients or patients waiting to go to the lab just right outside the maternity ward. So if you have a mother who's laboring, everybody gets to hear. They'll hear her moaning, they'll hear her, yeah, basically even when she's delivering, everybody will get to hear, oh, finally the baby is out, you know, like, which discourages most women to come during the day. They would probably rather come in the evenings when there's very few people around. And that has resulted in some delivering at home and some delivering on their way to the facility, maybe in the taxi or at home. So, yeah, there are those logistic challenges. Other than that, of course, our labor ward at the moment is the bed capacity is small. We would probably love it to be a little bit bigger, because we have 4 beds. Which cater for both postnatal and antenatal. And of course, our labor room, usually we have 1 person at a time, which is kind of adequate at the moment. Yeah. So basically, we need probably a little bit more room for our mothers. We need them to have a little bit more privacy when it comes to delivering, so that we don't have women delivering at home and having complications that when coming here when they have complications. Other than that, we don't really have enough space for their antenatal visits, and definitely to also improve on in terms of the maternity ward. The way it's been designed is in such a way that you are able to be in one room and be able to observe what is going on in the laboring room, which is excellent, because then you'd be able to tell if anything goes wrong or if there's progress in any way. Yeah, and intervene timely. So in terms of improving our work, yes, it will. And we also expect to have an increase in the mothers delivering from the facility, definitely, because once they know that they have a smart, clean facility and privacy, which is the main priority at the moment, definitely they'll be able to come in good time the moment they are probably in latent phase, and unlike when they are in active phase of labor. So it is going to be really a game changer to our facility. Yeah. Thank you very much for your support. Thank you.
I think hearing from Dr. Manyara and seeing even just a snapshot of the current situation there really puts things into perspective. And it really shows that the result of a new maternity ward will actually potentially save a lot of lives, which is what it's all about. So now we're going to be hearing from the lovely Sugra Hussain in Zambia, who has been the country director for Build It since 2014 and who oversees all the program work in Zambia. Sugra, are you there?
Good evening, everyone, and thanks so much for joining us today. I'm going to talk about our work in Zambia and the impact of COVID-19 on our activities and how we're moving forward. Our 2020 objectives included training 280 disadvantaged young people with in-demand skills, together with life skills training and work experience. We also planned on moving our community infrastructure projects from Lusaka and Chibombo districts to Livingstone in the southern province of Zambia. Now, despite having a good start to the year, one of the biggest impacts on our work has, of course, been the pandemic and the resultant closure of our training Centre for Excellence in late March this year. At the time of closure, we had 90 trainees active in training, and we were on track to reach our annual targets. So this was a sudden halt on quite a significant component of our work. However, I am pleased to say that we've devised and are now rolling out a distance learning program, which is enabling us to continue training through virtual lessons. And these lessons have been pre-recorded and loaded onto tablets, which are distributed in small groups to trainees on a weekly basis. Trainees also complete a basic assessment after each lesson and have a telephone follow-up with their trainer. So in this way, we don't rely on the internet, which is difficult to access for many of our trainees. We're further using this opportunity to raise awareness about COVID-19 and its prevention and management by embedding World Health Organization and Ministry of Health videos, posters and messages onto the tablets so trainees can watch these prior to the training session. The government of Zambia has recently announced that training institutions will be allowed to reopen from July, subject to inspections. So we are now planning for a phased reopening of training activities. We anticipate using a hybrid model of training, utilising distance learning together with training delivered on-site at the Centre for Excellence with social distancing in place. So we see the distance learning programme as key in enabling us to continue training in a safe way during these uncertain times. Our training activities at Katumbura Reformatory School, as part of a wider EU-funded Rise Again project, have largely been unaffected. We've been supporting this reformatory school since 2019 in the southern province of Zambia to deliver training to 180 juveniles using BuildIt's training model. With COVID-19 prevention measures in place, project staff at the facility have continued training and have continued with the programme. However, there has been a delay in starting the construction of a much needed shower and toilet block at the facility until it's safe to do so. We continue to engage with contractors in anticipation of placing our trainees in work placement later this year. We've also recently continued our career development programme to enhance opportunities for our graduates by engaging with very small groups of trainees with social distancing in place. Although the construction industry slowed down in April and May, many small to medium-sized contractors continue to work, and now some larger contractors are also resuming work, so we have carried on making linkages between employers and our graduates. We hope to continue advocating for our trainees, in particular for our female trainees, by communicating with stakeholders using technology as we are now, and when needed, face-to-face meetings with social distancing in place. Over the COVID-19 period, we have been able to continue our existing community building projects in Lusaka and in Chibombo. This includes Chitukuka Community School, where we have worked with BuildIt graduates and completed two newly designed low-cost teachers' houses and a 7-cubicle latrine block for girls. However, our three new Livingstone-based projects have been delayed. All of the projects are very much needed and set to have a big impact on the communities they serve. These include building a classroom block, teacher's house and latrines for Light of Hope Community School, which is a wonderful and energetic school serving a rural population of young children on the outskirts of Livingstone. The school currently relies heavily on volunteers in the community and only has rudimentary infrastructure to enable teaching. So our intervention here is really very much needed. In 2020, we also plan to improve facilities at Lubuyu Health Centre, which Dr. Manyara described earlier. This project would involve the refurbishment of the existing clinic, as well as the construction of a new maternity ward. This would be instrumental in providing a safe, secure, and adequate maternity and related services to the growing population of Lubuyu compound. Although making a start on these projects and moving some of our team to Livingstone has been delayed, we hope to make a start by September this year. We will, of course, continue to closely follow the progression of the virus in Zambia, as well as government measures to minimise the transmission and use our own guiding principles to decide when and how to safely start. And we at Build It International believe that we've got a responsibility to respond more specifically to some of the challenges that Zambia faces as a result of the pandemic. We focused on our strengths as an organization and devised a COVID-19 response program aiming to minimize the transmission of the virus amongst the most vulnerable communities. We will do this in two ways. To help schools cope to be ready for a more full reopening, we will provide a package of PPE and hand sanitization supplies, including face masks, to 18 community and government schools. And these schools consist of those that are already beneficiaries of our program, as well as new schools in the vicinity of the Center for Excellence. The second part of our intervention will provide more permanent hand wash facilities in schools through the installation of simple and robust hand wash stations that enable up to 18 children at a time to safely wash their hands. A total of 25,000 children are set to benefit. And Andrew will be providing more information about this in a moment. I'd like to finish by saying a big thank you to all of our supporters and partners for continuing to guide and believe in us in these unprecedented times. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Sugra. It was great to see your face again, and well done for all the fantastic work that you're doing out there. You really are so dedicated. Okay, so we're going to be hearing more from you, Sugra, because you are on our panel for the Q&A. We have got Andrew as well. We've also got Nicholas Woolley, the British High Commissioner to Zambia, and we also have Dr. Emma Stambouli. So we're going to start off with our questions. Just to let you all know, if we don't manage to get through them all, someone will get back to you after this evening. So our first question is for Nicholas, and it's from Amy B and Ali. They would like to know, how does UKAID support Zambia?
Hi, good evening. I'm here. Hope you can see me and hear me.
Yeah,
we've got
you.
Great. Okay, well, I just say what a pleasure it is to be here and to join the session this evening. And for all the Build It International team's work and for all the supporters the world over. So in terms of what UKAID does in Zambia, I'll be brief, but in summary, we've got a very extensive long-term partnership here, which is heavily focused on poverty reduction, which we've done so successfully for many years. So, for example, supporting the government make inroads into high malnutrition rates, tackling weaknesses in the health system, developing over at least the last decade the social transfer system to allow the most vulnerable in communities to benefit. So that's sort of one part. The second part is we're increasingly focusing on economic growth through job creation and attracting investment, particularly in our work to support small and medium-sized businesses here in Zambia. And then finally, we're active here in supporting some of the big global challenges like climate change, conservation, and of course, COVID-19.
Fantastic. Thank you so much, Nicholas. Okay, so for our next question, it's a question from Emma Kay for Dr. Emma Stambouli. From your experience in Zambia, how is COVID-19 impacting on the Zambian children and youth?
Good evening. Thank you very much. I'm happy to be part of this forum. I won't talk about education, the effect of COVID on education, because Doreen has already talked a lot about that. So I will talk about the impact of COVID on the socioeconomic aspect of the livelihoods. Because of COVID and the measures that were put in place, for example, the lockdown, most employers had to let go some of their employees because they were not making the money. And these employees have families and some of them have children. And so that has created a lot of hardships at home for them to be able to provide the meals to meet the other needs that the families were able to meet when they were earning their incomes. Also, a number of women who were selling living their lives, selling off the products on the road. They are not able to do that because the customers are on lockdown, and so no one is coming to buy. So a number of them have ended up misusing their capital or using the capital to meet the food needs. So that is affecting them. They won't be able to go back into those businesses which they were doing. And in the long term, the household has fallen more and more vulnerable. Also, because of the supply chains, the border, Zambia is an import-based country. So the borders were closed. And so that has affected the supply chain of some of the essential commodities. And so we've seen the prices going up. Again, that has increased the vulnerabilities of the already affected families and the children. So those are some of the main impacts that COVID has had on the children and the families in Zambia.
Yeah. Thank you, Emma. I've had one other question come in for you, which is, how hot is it in Zambia?
This is our cold season at the moment. Temperatures vary from, today it's about 17 degrees, and last week it went to as low as 3 degrees. So it's pretty cold.
Oh my gosh, we did our bike ride at the wrong time of year.
Yeah, you should have come now. Yeah.
So next I have a question from Maria for Sugra. Do you focus on people being self-employed or employed in construction projects? If self-employed, how do you train, coach them to make a small business work?
Thanks so much for the question. And the answer is we do both, really. Although the majority of our trainees and graduates, they're supported to actually go into formal employment. So most of our entry-level students and graduates, we support them by placing them in placement as part of the entry-level courses that they take. So they get that really essential hands-on experience that they need at this stage. But we do have a growing number of graduates who are really interested actually into looking into the world of self-employment. So we help them in two ways, really. One is through supporting them through our career development program, where we hold sessions on a monthly basis and encourage graduates to basically drop into the Centre for Excellence. And those that are interested in self-employment, we guide them through that process. And the second route is actually by essentially employing our own graduates from previous projects as contractors onto our new projects. And then we sort of guide them through that process and use it as a training opportunity, like we've actually done fairly recently at Chitukuko Community School, where we've had two of our previous graduates, Ben and Mike, in fact, who have brought on in small teams other BuildIt graduates, and they've acted as contractors, and we've given them some formal training along that process. So we do a bit of both, and we definitely recognise that the majority of our graduates, somewhere down the line, they're really interested in going into self-employment.
Which is fantastic.
Yeah.
Okay, so we have a question for the High Commissioner, which is, what do you think about the merger with FCO and DFID? I'm not sure if there's a nickname for it. I'm just going to spell it out.
Thanks for the question. Firstly, I've been asked that question many, many times in the last week since the Prime Minister announced to Parliament that the two departments would be merging. Particularly given he referenced specifically Zambia in his statement to Parliament, a lot of interest here. Secondly, I recognise that there's a lot of debate about it from all different sectors and lots of differences of opinion. But thirdly, what I would say is that this is about putting our development assistance and the expertise that DFID have built up over more than two decades right at the heart of our foreign policy. So it's about aligning both our aid and our foreign policy under a coherent set of international priorities that can help to address global challenges, including those here in Zambia.
Thank you, Nicholas. Thank you so much, Sugra and Emma, as well. I'm afraid that because we're on a bit of a schedule this evening, that's all we've got time for. However, there are some more questions for you, so we'll make sure that they get to you, and anyone who has sent them in, we'll make sure they're answered. Thank you so much for getting involved. Now, Andrea, you didn't get one. So I'm going to hand it over to you for a minute.
It's great having a panel. You didn't have to answer any questions. Thanks, colleagues. Now I've got an important announcement to share with you. We've heard from Doreen about the serious need for hand washing facilities for the 2,000 children at her school, and there are many, many more schools in a similar situation. And we've heard from Sugra that the team have developed a COVID-19 safe design for an 18 pupil hand washing station. And importantly, that we're going to use our graduates from our training program to install these systems. So today, we are launching our Safe Hands Appeal. Over the next few months, we aim to reach thousands of children in Zambia to ensure that they can safely wash their hands as they return to school. We'll also be supplying soap, sanitizer, and PPE where necessary. The cost of one hand wash station, as in the diagram there, is estimated to be £1,800. Now, if you include a month's supply of those consumables, the soap and a sanitizer and PPE and chlorine for disinfecting classrooms, that should work out at just £5 a pupil. Now, that's a really small price to pay to help keep our children safe. Now, here at Build It, we rarely launch fundraising appeals. Obviously, we have a fundraising team, but we don't do hard fundraising appeals as a matter of course. But now I really believe this is the right thing to do. So I'm asking you to consider supporting our Safe Hands Appeal and to share it with your friends and colleagues. You can make a donation directly through our website or get in touch with us, any of us, if you'd like to find out more details. I really hope that you'll come with us on this one. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Andrew. And thank you everyone who has joined us this evening, wherever you are in the world. I hope that you're well, and the video that we've created from this evening will be available on the website in the next few days. So feel free to share it. When you do, please do use our hashtag Building Brighter Futures. So the other thing is that you can get on the website is our annual review. If you haven't had one, looks a bit like this. You'll get that on the website as well. And you can also donate there. So you've seen the Safe Hands Appeal. I urge you to get involved and do so. Thank you so much for joining us. Thanks everybody for getting involved. Thank you for all your comments, and we'll get back to you. Until next year, hopefully we can do it in person. Hopefully. Thanks everybody. Bye.